from Vancouver, the world stage opening ceremonies at these Winter Olympics, but we are off to a tragic start. An athlete has died on a track many people said was just too fast. Extreme winter, a weather event across the United States tonight that seldom happens in keeping with our bizarre winter. Back home, President Clinton out of the hospital after that emergency heart procedure tonight. An update on his condition and what happens next. And downhill racer, she's been called the face of these Olympic Games for the U.S. team. She is injured but says she is ready tonight. The competitor, Lindsey Vonn. Nightly news from Vancouver begins now.
This is NBC Nightly News with Brian Williams, reporting tonight from the Olympic Winter Games in Vancouver.
And good evening from what will be our temporary home here in Vancouver. It all gets underway tonight, the first ever indoor opening ceremony, by the way, as Canada brings up the curtain on these games inside that very building here in Vancouver. Athletes from 96 nations, visitors from even more, cramming into 25,000 plus hotel rooms and every guest room they can find. They're coming by land, sea, and air. Good many of them making the three-hour drive north from Seattle across the border. The spectacle airs tonight, of course, and a good many Americans have reason to be inside and seated in front of the television. That's because there was measurable snowfall today in 49 of the 50 United States. A little bit more on that later on in the broadcast. Sadly, tonight we have to begin our reporting, though, from here with a tragic story. These games are off to a sad start before being officially underway. And an early warning here, while we've been judicious in using it, the videotape of what happened today may be tough for a lot of folks to watch. A competitor in luge was killed here today in a practice run. Everybody coming into these games knew the track was the fastest in the world. Today, in an instant, it turned violently unsafe. We want to begin with NBC's Chris Jansing. She's about 90 miles north of here at Whistler, the venues where luge and alpine skiing will be held. Chris, good evening.
Good evening, Brian. This terrible accident sent shockwaves through the Olympic community. And here in Whistler Village tonight, people are starting to gather to watch the opening ceremony on large screens. But earlier today on those same screens, they saw this devastating accident. And I can tell you a loud gasp went up from the crowd. So it's worth reiterating that these pictures are very difficult to watch. The International Luge Federation is investigating to see what factors might have contributed to the crash that took the life of a young athlete who was to compete at his first Olympics. The sled was already on the final turn of the track on the luger's final run of the day when the devastating accident happened. Nodar Kumaritashvili of the former Soviet Republic of Georgia lost control, went airborne over a concrete wall, and struck an unpadded steel pole just feet from the finish line. Emergency medical personnel were on the scene in less than a minute, and Kumaritashvili was quickly airlifted to a trauma center, but he couldn't be revived.
We are heartbroken beyond words to be sitting here.
Earlier in the day, the two-time defending men's gold medalist from Italy had crashed higher on the track, and a Romanian woman was briefly unconscious after crashing her sled, just two of more than a dozen accidents in this Olympic luge training.
The speeds are high, it's a dangerous course, however, this shouldn't have happened.
And at 21, Kumaritashvili is young for a luger, inexperienced by international standards. He was ranked 44th in the world, but there hadn't been a fatal luge accident in the Olympics in 46 years.
Sorry, it's a bit difficult to remain composed. This is a very sad day. Here you have a young athlete who lost his life in pursuing his passion. He had a dream to participate in the Olympic Games. I have no words to say what we feel.
In a split second, a young man's dream turned into international heartbreak. Shortly after the accident, I talked to the reigning world champion on the women's side of the luge. And these athletes spend a lot of time together. They train together, travel together, of course, compete against each other. Many of their families know each other. So this community is devastated tonight. Brian.
Chris Jansing, thanks. It is so sad and so shocking to watch. And as we said, it kind of creates a somber tone for tonight. And of course, all of this comes on the same day as this spectacular opening ceremony getting underway tonight. NBC's Donna Friesen is one of so many proud Canadians who are here for this tonight. She is our witness to the opening ceremonies. Donna, good evening.
Good evening, Brian. You know, it's been almost 7 years since Vancouver won the bid for these Winter Olympics. It's been waiting a long time for its Olympic moment, and now Vancouver feels like it's ready for its close-up.
Vancouverites like to think their city is a bit of a jewel. It's a stunning setting for the Winter Games, and with just hours to go,
go Canada!
People are getting into the spirit.
Do you think Vancouver's ready for the Games?
Yes!
From music on the streets,
go, 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 go!
To a zip line over downtown, this city is ready to welcome the world.
The city's got a bit of a smile on its face, and you know, it feels good.
5,500 athletes are here, including 216 Americans who are settling into the athletes' village.
The village is above and beyond anyone's expectations.
And California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger ran the Olympic torch in Stanley Park this morning. Some athletes got training runs in on the mogul course at Cypress Mountain, but at Whistler, fog and bad snow conditions meant training runs there were canceled, pushing back Lindsey Vonn's Olympic debut in the women's super combined alpine race. The opening ceremony tonight will be held at a covered stadium, BC Place. 3 billion viewers are expected to watch. It will be the first indoor opening ceremony. The epic performance in Beijing, a tough act to follow. Tonight's show will be more intimate, says executive producer David Atkins.
This ceremony has always been about intimacy. It's always been about emotion. It's always been about capturing the spirit of the people and the landscape here.
Mark Grimet, five-time Olympian from the luge team, will carry the American flag.
It's expected 250,000 people will descend on Vancouver for these games. It is by far the biggest event ever to hit this city.
There's a lot of pride here. Even the license plates declare it's the best place on earth. Now the pressure's on to prove it.
And obviously the joyous spirit here in Vancouver, tempered by the death of that Georgian athlete just hours before the opening ceremony. We understand that the opening ceremony will be dedicated to him tonight, and that the entire Georgian team who is here in Vancouver will go on to compete in the Olympics. Brian?
Everyone hoping for a happy and safe event, of course, over the next several days, especially for Canada, the host nation. Donna, thank you, as always. And of course, as the world gathers here, that makes this a giant security risk, all of it. And so there's a lot of security in place here. More than 15,000 police officers, military personnel, private security, all deployed at Vancouver and at the other venue at Whistler. We will see protests over a number of issues during the games, including a peaceful protest took place just this evening. Police have set aside designated areas for the protesters, but they're watching all of it from above. We'll have more from Vancouver a bit later on, including our interview with a young woman who's in an almost impossible must-win situation at these games, Lindsey Vonn. But first, some of the other news of this day. As we said at the top of the broadcast, today brought a highly unusual weather event to the United States. There was measurable snowfall today in 49 of the 50 United States. We'll confirm this with Mike Seidel of the Weather Channel as we throw to him covering snowfall in Atlanta. Mike, these are unusual times.
It's been a wild, wacky winter. Hawaii, the only state tonight without measurable snow on the ground. Meanwhile, today, about the only thing flying at Atlanta's airport, the world's busiest, were snowflakes. Over 1,200 flights were canceled ahead of the storm. Meanwhile, the storm struck first in Dallas-Fort Worth yesterday. Take a look at these aerial pictures. It looks more like Buffalo, an all-time record snowfall of 12.5 inches. The heavy, wet snow brought down thousands of trees and limbs on power lines. And tonight, 260,000 homes are without power. And then it moved into the deep south, the first snow in Mobile, Alabama in 12 years. But tragedy near Montgomery, a weather-related traffic accident left 2 children dead. Take a look at the snowfall totals tonight across Mississippi and Alabama. As much as 6 inches of snow fell in Vicksburg. Here in Atlanta, 3 inches. The seasonal average is a little over 2. And Brian, tonight, Charleston, South Carolina gets its first measurable snowfall in 10 years. This storm is heading out to sea, not up the eastern seaboard, to the snowflake cities of Philadelphia and D.C. And I have a feeling, Brian, that many of your viewers tonight in the east, along the eastern seaboard, would be more than happy to send some of the snow out to Cypress Mountain for the Winter Olympics. Back to you.
Absolutely. We keep mentioning, Mike, D.C. and Baltimore have had more snow this winter than Buffalo, New York. Mike Seidel at ATL for us tonight. Mike, thanks. When we left you last night, former President Bill Clinton was in the hospital having had an emergency heart procedure. He is out now and talking, and we get an update on his condition and prognosis tonight from NBC's Robert Bazell.
Speaking to reporters outside his home this afternoon, former President Clinton described being awake during the procedure and sensing the improvement right away.
It's a miraculous thing. You can feel the energy coming back right away when there's all the arteries are pumping to the heart.
Clinton left the hospital early this morning after an 18-hour stay. Doctors found a blockage in one of the arteries to his heart that had been implanted during bypass surgery in 2004. Doctors inserted balloons to place two stents, pieces of metal scaffolding, to reopen the blood flow to his heart. His doctors said Clinton will resume his normal schedule within a few days. He emphasized Clinton did nothing to bring on the problem.
This was not a result of either his lifestyle or his diet, which have been excellent. He's exercised regularly. He's in excellent condition.
Then why did one of his new arteries clog up again?
Cholesterol, blood pressure, these things that we can treat, represent only a portion of the risk for coronary disease. Genetics, the genetic predisposition to develop plaques in the coronary artery, is still a very important, perhaps even the dominant risk factor.
It is a condition the former president shares with almost 18 million other Americans. Doctors agree Clinton has every chance of living a long, normal life with no restrictions, although they say he will have to continue to closely monitor his heart health. Robert Bazell, NBC News, New York.
Congressman Patrick Kennedy, the second son of the late Senator Ted Kennedy, announced last night he will not seek re-election to Congress. While he is a Massachusetts Kennedy, he has represented Rhode Island in Congress for 8 terms. Kennedy has in the past battled depression and addiction. He gave an emotional eulogy, you may recall, at his dad's memorial service. Today he talked about stepping back away from politics in the wake of his father's death.
You know, I feel like I've been so blessed to have had the 15 years I had with my dad serving in Congress, and especially the last 2 years, to have gotten as close as I did with him, and to know that ultimately it's personal relationships that matter the most.
An emotional Congressman Patrick Kennedy says he plans to build on what he considers his biggest legislative achievement, a law that requires physical and mental health coverage to be treated equally in this country as he devotes himself to working on substance abuse issues. When Nightly News continues on a Friday night, a report from Haiti 1 month after the earthquake. And later, as we said, the American who has worked almost her entire life to get here, our conversation with Lindsey Vonn.
It's extraordinary.
Mysterious.
Spellbinding.
Welcome to Hogwarts.
The Wizarding World of Harry Potter at Universal Orlando Resort. What will it take for you to experience the magic? All is revealed at todayshow.com.
From overseas tonight, there is news about a massive offensive underway in Afghanistan designed to choke off hundreds of millions of dollars in opium money that flows to the Taliban. Up to 30,000 U.S., NATO, and Afghan forces are flooding into Taliban strongholds in southern Afghanistan's notorious Helmand province to drive Taliban insurgents and opium traffickers out. This is a big offensive. 60% of the world's supply of opium comes from just that region. In Haiti, this was a national day of mourning to mark 1 month exactly since the devastating earthquake that has killed more than 200,000 people. There has been progress in the recovery there, but there are still as many as 1 million people with no home and badly needing help. NBC's Mike Taibbi is in Port-au-Prince tonight.
Brian, all over Haiti today in gatherings, large and small, Haitians pause to reflect and to mourn. President Rene Préval, who'd been widely criticized here for his silence during this crisis, said he just didn't have the words in the beginning to match the horror of his country's devastation. But now, he said, we must wipe our tears and rebuild. Haiti must not just disappear. And there are some encouraging signs 1 month in. More food distribution, hundreds of cash for work programs, for example, all keyed in large part by the more than $500 million in aid provided by the United States. Brian?
Mike Taibbi, part of our team in Port-au-Prince, Haiti. Mike, thanks. Quick look at Wall Street today. Stocks lost some ground. Dow was down 45 points, but that was well off the lows of the day. When we come back here after a break, the American being called the star of these games, the face of these games, she says she's ready to go.
Who's making tomorrow's history today?
The extraordinary men and women of the Griot's 100. From all walks of life, they're changing our world.
Their stories this month on NBC News.
And forever on thegriot.com.
We're back, and now to the woman on the American Winter Olympic team who's getting so much of the attention coming into Vancouver. She's gotten a lot of it since arriving here, in fact. The American skier, Lindsey Vonn. She's carrying the hopes and dreams of a lot of folks along with her, but she's injured. We will soon find out how badly injured, though. She says she is ready, and give her this. She's been preparing for these games just about as long as she's been alive. One sports writer called her the face of the Vancouver Olympics. What Michael Phelps was to the Summer Games, Lindsey Vonn could be on snow.
I really hope these games will be my time where my dreams come true, because I have given everything. I've given my entire life for the sport.
She'll be racing with a painful shin injury, but it won't be the first time she's fought through injuries. At the last Winter Olympics, she crashed hard during downhill training and was rushed to a hospital by helicopter. She was bruised and in pain, but on sheer tenacity, she got back on her skis, racing just 48 hours later and finishing in the top 10.
Hi, Dad, Mom.
Lindsey Vonn started small as a little kid on a hill in Minnesota so diminutive the locals called it the bump. Her father, Alan Kildow, is a former ski racer. He had her on skis at the age of 3 and bribed her with sprinkled donuts and hot chocolate at the end of a successful run.
Who won, Lindsey? You won!
By the second grade, her mother said Lindsey had it pretty much figured out.
She wrote that she wanted to win more gold medals than anyone has ever won before. And that was at 7 years old.
Her childhood idol was Olympic gold medalist Peekaboo Street, who actually remembers the day Lindsey Vonn stood in line to meet her.
She just had an intensity in her eyes that I could see.
I thought to myself, this is who I want to be. I want to be just like Peekaboo.
And then when I saw her ski for the first time, got her up on snow. She has a love for the fall line that you cannot teach somebody.
Peekaboo Street became Lindsey's mentor. What is it that you feel deep down that you know about snow and your sport that kind of has been your secret?
What I know best is line, you know, where to go and how to make speed. And when I'm skiing, it's like second nature. I just do it.
When it gets tough for you, injury, challenge, bad run, who is it? Who's over your shoulder? Who's in your head?
My husband. He's, if I'm stressed, if I'm nervous, if I doubt myself, he's always the one there making things more real.
Her husband is Thomas Vonn, a former U.S. ski racer, now her coach. They call their team the Vontourage, and when the pressure gets high, they use humor to keep the mood light.
We have to manage that, you know, kind of that switch between
business and pleasure.
Personal pleasure.
Personal.
Lindsey Vonn is a living example of Minnesota nice, modest despite all her fame. Home these days is Vail, where she trained as a kid and where she's now a local celebrity.
I made a mini portrait of you on the macaroni.
Her husband says the truth is it's Lindsey who gets starstruck by celebrities.
I'm going to stalk.
In her off hours, she's a Law and Order junkie. This fall, she finally got to visit the set of the show in New York and meet the cast. And now comes the publicity for Lindsey Vonn, who right now seems to be everywhere.
Action!
But for Lindsey Vonn, at the end of the day, and at these games, it's all about getting out on the snow.
When I met Peekaboo, she was so inspiring to me, and I was, you know, this young, impressionable girl, and I imagine, you know, those girls sitting by the TV watching me ski, and I want to make them proud as well. People are expecting things of me, but I'm excited to really show them who I am and hopefully inspire some young kids.
And again, our first opportunity to see Lindsey Vonn on skis is still in flux because of the bad weather. The alpine skiers have had no opportunity to practice. Sunday's event has been postponed because the women have not had a chance to train on this downhill course. We're back with more from Vancouver, however, in just a moment.
I always felt that politics was a great story, and I wanted to cover the great story. There's a huge responsibility to be the person who holds people accountable. There's no other place that I'd like to be. If it's Sunday, it's Meet the Press.
Back here in Vancouver, tonight is a big night for a great country, and I thought I would ask friend, colleague, and genuine Canadian, Kevin Tibbles of our NBC family about this. A lot of people felt terrible about, obviously, the death of the luger today and how it will affect, perhaps, you know, understandably dampen the spirits tonight.
Well, obviously, because it has happened in Canada, I think it probably is reverberating across the country that this young man lost his life here, attending this spectacle that was supposed to put Canada in front of the world's view. And even as John Furlong, the head of VANOC, the Vancouver Olympic Committee, said today that, you know, that we are going to handle this in a Canadian way, and that was that he meant that they were going to be upfront about it, but at the same time, they are genuinely sad about the loss of this young man today here in Vancouver. And let's hope the rest of the games come off successfully.
I was just going to say, I'm sure it'll be a successful games when we reach the end and have that conversation. Reminder, NBC Sports coverage of the opening ceremony, Winter Olympics coming up at 7:30 Pacific time. For now, though, for our team here, that's our broadcast for this Friday night. Thank you, as always, for being with us. I'm Brian Williams, reporting tonight from Vancouver. We hope to see you right back here tomorrow evening. Good night.